honor for me to introduce the Raqqa Public Charitable Trust and the man behind the trust, Dr. N.M. Raqqa. Dr. N.M. Raqqa, a senior advocate in the field of tax laws, a philanthropist and tax expert of national repute, established the Raqqa Public Charitable Trust in the year 1980. He was chairman and faculty at more than 750 tax conferences and was honoured by the All India Federation of Tax Practitioners as the AFTP Man of the Millennium and conferred as the Jain Seva Ratna by Sri Jain Seva Sangh, Mumbai. He was conferred with the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in recognition of his eminence and contributions in legal practice by JERC University of Jaipur. He was patron and past president of many tax and professional associations and a trustee of a large number of charitable trusts and societies in the educational and medical fields. Manasa, being a firm believer of Gandhian philosophy, the trust has installed more than 49 statues of Mahatma Gandhi in various high courts, central jails, and universities in India. Over 500 articles, numerous books have been written and distributed on a variety of topics. In order to promote tax education and awareness, the trust also gives the Raqqa Tax Conference Award under the banner of All India Federation of Tax Practitioners Mumbai to the deserving Tax Bar Association. The trust has also adopted a government primary upper school in Jaipur, wherein more than 200 students are being given free education and boarding facilities. The trust has pioneered in organizing and sponsoring the moot court competitions in Rajasthan, and around 30 competitions have been organized in collaboration with the five-year law college of Rajasthan University, the Manipal University, and University Law College of Jaipur. More than 2,000 students have come to Jaipur from colleges across the country. Following the success of the student-centric events, we are pleased to let you know that we have gone international too. The trust endeavors to organize moot courts for the law students. Monthly webinars are being organized with eminent senior honorable judges of Supreme Courts and High Courts, collaborating with law colleges and universities of repute. Dr. N.M. Raqqa was undoubtedly an incredible man, but today I'd like to give you a glimpse how I saw him. Since I was a child, I've always admired the way Nanasa laughed, with pure joy in his eyes and a slight tinge of pink on his cheeks. He would glow from within. For me, Nanasa and Nanisa were a team. Their unconditional love, respect, and understanding between them projected onto their life together. And one would find that the doors of Raqqa House would always be open for everyone and for everything. Together, they demonstrated immense strength of character, honesty, integrity, and generosity of spirit. Whether that be through altruistic acts or simply in the love for his law students, whom he lovingly called his grandchildren. In my conversations with him, often over breakfast, he taught me that dreams should be lofty. They should challenge you. They should excite you so that you keep pursuing them even when the challenges are difficult. Their pursuit should define your character, but should never have a time limit. He taught me to be patient and ambitious, to be well prepared and to be strong. He urged me to positively influence others, both present and into the future. The work of our future requires a very important ingredient, one that's been overlooked, but increasingly recognized as a central part of our new emerging economy: empathy. Empathy allows ourselves to put ourselves in other people's shoes and experience life through their eyes. It challenges us to look beyond the immediate benefit to me and consider what's best for us. It opens us to possibilities that, with only profit in mind, are out of reach. Living a life that matters does not happen by accident. It is not a matter of circumstance, but of choice. So today I urge you all to do one thing. Choose to be great instead of big. We need not strive to be the biggest, but rather measure our success by the impact we have, the inspiring people we get to work with, the joy we experience, the wisdom we learn, and the legacy we leave behind for future generations. That is how we define greatness. And without a moment of hesitation, I am proud to know that my Nanatha, Dr. N.M. Raka, was truly a great man. With folded hands, I welcome you all for this chapter of the lecture series. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sanskriti ma'am, for your kind words. Now, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Nathul Lal Gujjar sir for the welcome address on behalf of Vivekananda Global University, Jaipur. Over to you, sir.
First of all, I would like to share my thanks to every participant in this August gathering. I am very thankful to the today chief speaker Justice Ambani sir, Justice J.K. Raka sir, and every participant. It is a great pleasure to us that such a webinar during the pandemic period, it is a very grateful contribution to the towards the our Biju and Raka Charitable Trust family and their members. It is a big contribution to the nation, and the every webinar they took very current topics in the very topic in the current scenario, and I am thankful to the Justice J.K. Raka sir, who and Madam Raka is very grateful to cooperate every month a series of lecture on the remembrance of the Justice N.M. Raka sir. I am personally known. He was a very great personality in the country. He was a very famous jurist, advocate, thinker, writer, and the taxation experts. So it is a very grateful contribution. And the every in this seminar, very important and current topic may be chosen in the every webinar. So I am thankful. Every student will be benefited this webinar through the various sources of law, legislation, and the various current decision and scenarios of the countries. So burning issue, burning dimension, burning implication, and burning the problem raised in the every webinar. So the every student and the legal fraternity surely benefited from this webinar. So I am sure on behalf of the Biju family and the Biju School of Law, it will be very fruitful. I am sure to say that it will be very useful to the every gentleman, to every expert in the law field and the general layman. So it is a very, very, very important. I am thankful to the every organizer who are taking their full cooperation, full help, and full motivation, and they keenly taking interested in the and choose the current topic. So it will not be only the useful for the liars, but it will be various the in the country. 5-year culture, 5-year integrated honors course, or research student. So it will be very useful. Listener and every researcher, I am very, very thankful to today the current topic chosen by the in this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your kind words. Now, I would like to invite Honorable Mr. Justice J.K. Ranka, former judge, Raisan High Court, for the keywords about the topic. Over to you, sir.
Sir, you are on mute.
My esteemed Honorable Brother Justice Sunil Ambani, sir. My former Chief Justice, Honorable Mr. Justice V.S. Dave Uncle in absentia, Professor Anil Gurjar, Dean, VGU University, Srimati Rati Sharma, Senior Faculty in VGU, and I can notice Honorable Justice P.K. Srivastav, former judge, in the audience, other esteemed guests, dear students, my family members, and all present. I, on my own behalf, on behalf of my family, and especially Rajasthan Education Trust, of whom I am also a trustee, which was formed by the father of Honorable Mr. Justice Suresh Chandra Agarwal ji, former Judge Supreme Court, and myself and Justice Dave are the trustees of Rajasthan Education Trust, and our trust as well as Rajasthan Education Trust having similar objectives, we decided that we will organize moot courts, and Rajasthan Education Trust in turn would organize other events for the benefit and welfare of the students, where we are organizing internship programs for the young students. I have very fond memories of being with Honorable Justice Sunil Ambani Sahab when he was in Rajasthan as a Chief Justice. A great personality, a great orator, a legal brain of the country. And he has given so much immense contribution to this legal fraternity in his career as a judge, of course, more than 17 years. And then being an eminent lawyer of Allahabad High Court and initially Delhi High Court, he played a great innings in this judicial world. While in Rajasthan, he created a great good atmosphere, and things were not in good shape for some time. And he gave guidance to the judicial officers that you work without fear and favor, and we are there to protect you. And that signal of the Chief Justice plays certainly an immense role in the lower judiciary. And he's remembered of that time when he gave free hand to the judicial officers that don't worry, don't come in under any pressure or otherwise. The topic of that today's day is also concerned with that feeling itself. When I requested Brother Justice Ambani Sahab, he said that this subject is close to my heart. And yes, I said, sir, certainly, because I have heard you on this subject while you were in Rajasthan, and certainly for the benefit of the students, we would request you to speak on this subject, which is prime not only to a lawyer, a student, any professional, rather, I say that any official, any politician, it should be that ethics should be in blood of a person. One should be ethical in all respect, in all regard. irrespective of any profession. And once you are ethical, you are honest to yourself, to your country, then one should certainly see that prosperity is there. One more facet in Honorable Justice Ambani's cap was that, of course, my also, that we were together conferred senior designation after retirement.
Yes.
And both of us had that honor of being designated senior advocates by the Honorable Supreme Court, full bench. And that I had a benefit with Honorable Justice Ambani sir. Maybe because I sat with him for some time that my proposal was accepted to be conferred with a senior advocate. Be that as it may, BGU is a budding university. Of course, they are having a good students now over the 3-4 years of their standing, and it has come up very well. And with Vivekanand Global University, we would be organizing our first moot court competition, national moot court competition, next month from 22nd to 24th October. Well, friends, when Honorable Justice Ambani Saab is there, I need not say anything on the subject, because as I've already begun that one should be ethical to any humble beginning. And certainly, as a lawyer, as a professional, one has to be having all these. This should be the first step in the right direction for a lawyer to be ethical in all respects. Legal profession, as it is said thousands of years back, that it's a noble profession. Vakil keh lijiye pehle, Arji Nabeez, matlab there were earlier different meanings, names, pleaders were there. So time immemorial, they have been said to be carrying a noble profession. Whether it is chartered accountants or professionals or lawyers, they certainly, it's a noble profession. And once a lawyer, always a lawyer. And that should be that one should be courteous to the client, courteous to the court, and everything carries. And of course, Bar Council of India also framed rules as to what should be the image of a lawyer, how a lawyer should be, not only before the honorable judge, but to the other side, to the litigant, to the opposite side, and everything. Ethical standards include independence, honesty, and integrity. The legal profession is necessarily the keystone of the arc of government. If it is weakened and allowed to be a subject of the corroding and demoralizing influence of those who are controlled by craft, greed, or gain, or other unworthy motive, sooner or later the arc must fall. And friends, with these initial words, I am keen to hear Honorable Justice Ambani Saab, and certainly all students and the audience present here would have a great delight listening to such a great orator. Over to Honorable Justice Ambani Saab through Parth. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. Now, I would like to invite Honorable Mr. Justice D.S. Dave, sir, former judge, Rajasthan High Court, for words of wisdom.
Of course, we are missing Honorable Justice Dave, sir, but he has sent a clip which should be played before the audience. A most respected Honorable Judge of the country, at the age of 92, Justice Dave is still very active and is always available for all causes to the litigation or to the students or legal fraternity. Yes, please go ahead.
Plata
and dear participants. I extend to you all a warm welcome today in this seminar. I regret I am not personally present today owing to some unavoidable circumstances. Hence, an apology. Hope you will grant me leave of absence. This is Rakai, the trustee with me in Rajasthan Education Trust. And I come from a discipline where when one of the judges writes a judgment, if unless there is a disagreement, it is enough to say I agree. And I agree with whatever Justice Rakai is going to tell you today. And Justice Ambani too. Friends, before I proceed further, let me pay my humble tribute to the memory of late Sri N.M. Ranga, a doyen of the bar, late Sri C.L. Agarwal, a great lawyer who dominated the scene for four decades, and my esteemed friend, who was the chairman of the Rajasthan Education Trust and recently passed away. This is S.C. Agarwal. Friends, I extend to you all a very warm welcome today. On behalf of myself and on behalf of the trust, that is Rajasthan Education Trust, the subject on which Honorable Justice Ambani is going to talk to you is of prime importance today, as the rules are more followed these days in breach rather than in observance, because the profession of law is becoming a business rather than a profession, as I see from the conduct of many of the lawyers. I was associated with the framing of the rules since in the first initial 20 years after commencement of the Act. I had been a member of the Bar Council of Rajasthan, then member of the Bar Council of India, and chairman of the Discipline Tribunal. As such, we had been very strict during those days for implementation of the laws about the misconduct of the cases. I do not want to come into new and the principal speaker, Honorable Justice Ambani, and once again welcome you to this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now we have come to the most important part of our webinar. We feel very honored to introduce our chief guest of this webinar, Honorable Mr. Justice Sunil Ambani sir, former Chief Justice, Rajasthan High Court. Retired former Chief Justice, Rajasthan High Court, LLB First Division in 1976 from University of Allahabad, enrolled advocate UP Bar Council in 1976, advocate on record, Supreme Court 1986, appointed as Special Counsel High Court in 1999, appointed Permanent Judge, Allahabad High Court in 2001, chaired Mediation Committee for 6 years, Computer Committee for 3 years at Allahabad High Court and UP State Legal Authorities, appointed Judge of Rajasthan High Court in 2014, and Chief Justice in 2015, revised in 9th edition, volume 10-11 of D.D. Basu on Constitution of India, chaired E-Committee, Supreme Court of India in 2016 and 17, designated Senior Advocate by Supreme Court in 2017, sources person N.J.A. Bhopal, presently serving as an arbitrator for various corporations and PSUs at New Delhi. So I humbly now invite Honorable Mr. Justice Sunil Ambani sir to take over. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Can you hear me well, Parth?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Parth, for giving an introduction which I don't really deserve. Thank you, Justice Ranka sahab, Justice J.K. Ranka sahab. We had a very good time, both sitting in bench and the High Court. Is a very humble person. I respect him a lot. respected Justice V.S. Dave, we are missing you in this webinar, but your message and blessings was very welcome. You have a very towering personality and the most respected judge in Rajasthan. I also had the privilege of having his blessings when I was in Jaipur. Thank you, Sanskriti Mehta. You have joined from Australia. That's a very encouraging thing. Thank you for your kind words and the remembrance of your Nana Saab, the great Mr. N.M. Ranka. Justice J.K. Ranka happened to tell me many times about the achievements of his father, Dr. N.M. Ranka, the tax expert. Apart from that, he was a towering personality and had a great vision. I've gone through the material which Justice J.K. Ranka has sent, the installation of statues of Mahatma Gandhi as a symbol of honesty, integrity, and great values in life, the holding of several seminars, giving a scholarship to the students. I'm very happy that Justice J.K. Ranka and his family is carrying the great tradition which was instilled in them by Mr. N.M. Ranka. Thank you, Professor Dr. Gurjar Sahib, for introducing the subject. I can also see Justice Pramod Kumar Srivastav ji. We had a very good association in Allahabad. I remember him very much. And many a times we talked about. And we did some very good work there in every field. Thank you for joining this program. Let me come to the topic. Ethics in legal profession. You know, as a student of law, I passed out from Allahabad University. That was a 3-year course, 1975. I frankly and honestly tell you that Allahabad is a big university. It's a great university. It has turned out many legal luminaries, some very, very important luminaries like Shanti Bhushan ji and several Chief Justices of India. But during that period, no one told us about legal ethics. In fact, the word itself was strange to me. And I came across this for the first time when I appeared in the Advocate on Records examination in Supreme Court in 1985, December. I was surprised as to what has legal ethics got to do with the legal profession. But then the seniors in Supreme Court and also seniors in Allahabad High Court told us that ethics is a potent weapon. It's a big defense to the lawyer. If you follow ethics, you'll be protected. Ethics is not just to follow. Ethics is the crux of the profession. People trust you because you follow legal ethics. That court trusts you because you are ethical in your behavior. Now with that, when I appeared in the examination, then I realized the importance of it. And then we had one distinguished professor from Banaras Hindu University who teaches ethics in engineering. Now that again was an eye-opener. We met him at the mediation center in Allahabad. And then we realized that ethics is the crux of the whole life. You know, ethics is something which is between father and son, mother and son, brother and brother, between neighbors. These are age-old practices, good practices of life, which are followed. If we take away the ethics from our life, I sometimes feel that we'll become not just unethical person, but our behavior would become an animal-like behavior. So, ethics governs almost every relationship, every personality, every profession, every vocation. And it is equally important in law. In law, it's more important because, you know, a lawyer's job is not a private profession. lawyers feel that they are in a private vocation, they are doing something which is individual and personal to them. I don't think that they are correct in that approach. A lawyer is a very important person in society. A lawyer has a very multifarious roles. You know, in olden times, when in some किसी परिवार में या किसी गांव में कोई वकील हो जाता था, उसकी बड़ी इज्जत हो जाती थी. लोग कहते थे कि ये वो परिवार है जिसमें इनके एक वकील साहब है, इस गांव में एक वकील है, इस गांव में तीन वकील हैं, इस गांव में आठ वकील हैं. इट यूज टू बी अ मैटर ऑफ ऑनर. दैट इज द इम्पोर्टेंस, सोशल इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ एन एडवोकेट इन सोसाइटी. ही बिकम्स वर्चुअली अ लीडर ऑफ द सोसाइटी. एंड हाउ कैन देयर बी अ लीडर इन द सोसाइटी विदाउट एथिक्स? Now, before I take up this subject, item-wise, I would like to just introduce you to you how this legal profession came to be regulated. You know, there is a reference in Tagore Law Lectures. There is a old reference by Mr. K.P. Jaiswal, a great legal scholar, in his topic Manu and Yajnavalkya, in which he said that even in that time, in the time of Manu, there were lawyers and they used to follow Manava code. Even that time they had ethics in their function. They may not have that qualification, or they may not have been enrolled by any bar council like today, but even the ethics were followed by lawyers or those who were representing their clients in the king's courts. Now, our history, legal history starts. It's a very long history. I will not take you to that. Because in the company's courts, in the East India Company's courts, which came to be established firstly in Calcutta and thereafter in Madras, they used to have barristers. The Barrett Law of England and Barrett Law and the lawyers from Ireland, they used to rule. There was the lawyers in India were called natives. Natives were not supposed to be having a right to practice in the courts of Sadar Diwani Adalat. Our actually legal history with regard to legal profession begins after the 1987 mutiny, the first war of revolution in India. Then the whole thing changed. Then the East India Company was asked to go back. And under the Queen's Charters, the high courts were established. The entire legal system was established. We had first chartered high courts in Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay. And with that came the Legal Practitioners Act. First, there was the regulation of 1827, and then Legal Practitioners Act 1847. The Chartered High Courts were established in 1861. And thereafter, the other high courts came to be established. The Allahabad High Court was established in 1866 by Queen Victoria's charter. And under that charter, there are various rules, regulations, how the courts will function, where the benches will sit. The high courts had the power to enroll the advocates. And at that time, there would be six category of advocates. There were various category of advocates. There were, the categories were advocates and advocates, attorneys and wakils. Attorney, advocates, attorneys and wakils. And on the lower category side, there used to be pleaders, mukhtars and revenue agents. Now pleaders, mukhtars and revenue agents did not have a right to practice in the high court. If a Vakil wanted to practice. If a Mukhtar wanted to practice, then he had to pass an examination and became a Vakil. Then from Vakil, he became an advocate. All these categories were actually enrolled, and they used to practice with the permission of the High Court. And all the disciplinary powers remained with the High Courts. They could remove a lawyer from the rolls when they would not be entitled to practice. And they were admitted as advocates on the qualification that they are eligible, qualified, and under good conduct. they had to be gentlemen. They had to appear before the court to get an enrollment for the High Court. Now, thereafter, in 1879, after we have Legal Practitioners Act, then for the first time they realized that they should not be strictly under the control of the High Courts. They should have some independence because they were not servants of the High Court. Old concept was that all these persons, all these categories of persons who could represent were servants of the High Court. But no longer it was there. In the Legal Practitioners Act 1879, they realized that advocates must have an independence. But that independence would come at the cost of following ethics. And the monitor of that ethics would be High Courts. One very interesting incident I'll tell you. There was one Miss Hazra who passed a BL degree from Patna and she applied to become enrolled as an advocate. The Patna High Court refused the enrollment on the ground that at that time the regulations of enrollment said a male member can be enrolled. So that at that time the Chief Justice of Patna High Court said a very interesting thing. He said, I'm sorry, I cannot enroll you because you are not male, you are a female. And he interpreted the rules in a very interesting fashion. It will be very interesting to know for those who are at present in the movement of feminism and fighting for the women's rights. What he said was that though there is no direct prohibition, but inferentially by words, appropriate only to male sex, as though the matter were well settled by inveterate usage and requiring no express legislation. He refused. And it was for the first time, it was the Allahabad High Court. Sir Grimwood Mears was at that time the Chief Justice of that High Court. He enrolled Miss Cornelia Sorabji as the first lady advocate in 1921, 100 years ago. Earlier to that, the men did not have a right to be enrolled. All right, that is just the by the way. It has nothing to do with legal ethics and profession. But this is, I'm telling you how the profession came into being. Then what happened that in the year 1923, a Munshi Ishwar Saran moved a resolution in the Legislative Assembly in United Provinces to create a unified bar to remove all the distinctions between barristers and wakils and to constitute one recognized body to provide legal education and to exercise disciplinary control over the bar and deal with the matters of the legal profession. Now, on this resolution, a committee was appointed in 1923. It was known as Chamier's Committee. Sir Edward Chamiers, retired Chief Justice of Patna High Court, he was heading the committee. He made recommendations on which the Bar Councils Act 1926 was enacted. Now, this is prior to independence. This Bar Council Act was enacted in 8 states, including Allahabad, in which Advocate General and 14 members, out of which 4 were nominated by the High Court and 2 could be judges of the High Court. Then what happened? Slowly and gradually, when India became independent, we realized that we must have an independent and strong bar. Lawyers, as leaders of society, were not only leaders. You know, in the first parliament, almost more than half the members of the parliament were lawyers. So they realized that we must have an independent bar. Independent bar is a safety. It independent power to secure the goals which are given in the Constitution of India. And the bar cannot be independent unless and until it is independent of the present dispensation of the judicial system and independence of the executive. So an All India Bar Committee was constituted with Mr. Justice S.R. Das as its chairman. Mr. Justice S.R. Das was one of the celebrated and very respected judge of the Supreme Court. And The Law Commission was also constituted by that time. So the 14th report of the Law Commission gave the recommendations on which this Advocates Act came to be enacted. And today, all the lawyers who are practicing in the courts or even non-practicing in the courts or occupying different fields, either they are professors, or executive officers, having law degrees, they are enrolled by the state bar councils, which are under Section 6 of the Advocates Act. The state bar council has got various functions. State bar council is not just a place for a power play by lawyers. It admits persons as advocates on its rolls. It prepares and maintains the rules. It entertains and determines the cases of misconduct against the advocate. And you know, there are various other activities like establishing law libraries, giving legal aid, which not many bar councils are doing. And then in this Advocates Act, Bar Council of India was established. The Bar Council of India, the first defined role of the Bar Council of India under Section 7(1)(b) of the Advocates Act is to lay down standards of professional conduct and etiquette for the advocates. Professional conduct and etiquette for the advocates, that's what we are going to talk about today. Then to lay down the procedures to be followed by the disciplinary committee to safeguard the rights and privileges and interests of the advocates, etc., etc. With this, an independent bar came to be established, an independent bar which will enroll advocates who will have a right to practice. Now, immediately a need was felt to have some regulations for the conduct of the advocate, regulations for conduct of the advocates towards court, towards clients, towards their fellow colleagues, towards the civil society. Now, these are the regulations which have been framed by the Bar Council in the year under Section 49(1). These regulations which have been framed, they're called Rules Governing Advocates. They are in Part 6 of the Bar Council of India rules. Now, why is the need of this? What is the purpose of having the... Is it not enough that the advocates... when they come to the court, they learn these etiquettes, they know what is good conduct or a bad conduct, or what is ethical or not ethical. You know, advocates, on their enrollment, after getting qualification as LLB and getting enrollment, they get three very distinct rights. These rights are not available to other professionals. They are very cherished, very important rights. One of the rights is that advocates can appear in any court in India. They can practice in any court of India. Of course, within 6 months, they have to get themselves enrolled if they're permanently shifting to that other state. You know, this right is so cherished right that although Section 29 and 30 of the Advocates Act provide for these rights, but actually they came to be notified much later in 2011. And the right to practice in every court, in every tribunal, and every such court which has a power to take evidence. And advocates alone can represent. Client can himself represent. There is no difficulty about it. If the client is educated enough, he understands his rights, and he knows the practices and procedures of the court, he has a first right to represent his hand in his case. But then, the persons, qualified persons who represent the suitors or non-suitors or litigants, those who have been prosecuted or are prosecuting, or their plaintiffs and defendants, any category of person who comes to the court is given to an advocate. It's a very important right. The second right which is given is under the Evidence Act. This is the crux of the legal profession. Section 126, 127, and 129 of the Evidence Act. Section 126 gives protection to the lawyers, to the legal professionals. Who are the legal professionals? Those who are qualified and those enrolled. Any communication between the client and the counsel cannot be subject matter of evidence. A police cannot ask what advice was given to you by the counsel. Court cannot ask what advice did you give. It's a privileged communication. And this privileged communication is not only extended to lawyers, but is also, very surprisingly, it is extended to the lawyers' clerks, lawyers' secretaries, and lawyers' stenographers. Even they are protected. You know what happens is when a person is charged with any crime, he goes to the lawyer, or he has to file a suit, or a defender suit goes to the lawyer. Lawyers give him advice. This advice may or may not be taken by the client before he comes to the court. But this advice cannot be subject matter of scrutiny. No one can cross-examine the lawyer and the person. There is a big principle of law behind it that without such advice and communication, a person cannot defend his rights. You know, we had one problem in mediation when we were setting up mediation centers. Very one big issue came up as to whether lawyers should participate, whether they should sit on the table with the parties and the sessions of the mediation. Our immediate reaction was, "Arey, vakil saab to case bigaad denge. Wo to tay ho, settle hone hi nahi denge." But you know, when we were told that, look, at the table, there is a mediator and parties. Who's going to protect the rights of the parties? Suppose the parties want to get into a settlement which is not legal in law. Suppose the mediator is out of anxiety to get the matter settled, is giving an advice which has been followed by the parties, by which they are getting into a legal trap for future. Who's going to protect them? It is the lawyer who's going to protect. Lawyer plays a very important part. Lawyer not only represents his clients, he protects his rights. He also protects his future rights. So that's an important role. Now, what happens if the lawyer is sued by his client? Suppose the client says, "Mujhe galat advice di gayi, mujhe sahi baatein batai nahi gayi, mere original papers lawyer ne rakh liye, court mein mere case ko concede kar diya mere rights ke khilaf." Now these kind of allegations come. Do you know what protects the advocates? The judge doesn't protect. These rules of conduct protect. So long as the lawyer acts in accordance with these rules of ethics, rules of conduct, which have been framed and codified now by the Bar Council of India, he is protected. No action can be taken against him. If he can establish in court that he has been following the professional etiquettes and standards, then he is not liable for any wrongdoing which the client may have an apprehension against him. So I have always said, following ethics is the it's not a right of the lawyer, it's a protection of the lawyer. It's less like an armor which you are wearing. You can always say that I am within my rights to give an advice to my clients, which is protected by the Evidence Act. What I have done is strictly in accordance with the conduct which has been prescribed under the Bar Council regulations. That is the importance of the ethics. Now, what are these professional ethics? Now, duties, I'm not going to read or explain to you all of them. The Bar Council of India rules are there, and standards of professional conduct and etiquettes are in chapter 2. You can read them. I'll just tell you some very important ethical standard rules. This is a very important subject for law students also. I think all law students must go through this Advocates Act and the regulations of the bar, which have been framed by the Bar Council. And also, the Bar Councils, now there is a bar examination. I don't know what has happened, because my daughter has passed the bar examination. People are appearing in bar examinations. But whether that's a mandatory condition to be enrolled as a lawyer, that still has not been established. There are various gray areas and issues are there. But there must be not the bar examination. But what I believe is that every bar counsel, before the lawyer is enrolled, of course, he's enrolled subject to the adherence of these ethics. But does he know it? He must subscribe to it. Just like a judge takes oath, just like, say, and declaration is given by every public servant before he takes office, a lawyer also should give a declaration. Declaration that I have read these rules of conduct and etiquettes framed by the Bar Council of India, and I shall adhere to them. It is on these conditions that his enrollment should stand. Actually, it stands, but very few know it very well. Now, let me come to duty towards the court. It says, the advocate shall, during the presentation of his case, acting before a court, conduct himself with dignity and self-respect. Now, remember one thing. You have to respect the court. But you can't respect the court unless you respect yourself. And how do you respect yourself? You have to conduct well. You have to wear a proper dress. You have to address the court properly. You have not to exceed your brief. You cannot talk irrelevant. These are all ingredients of humility and dignity and self-respect. He shall not be servile. It's a very important thing. A lawyer is not a servant of the court. A lawyer should not come under the dictates of the court. When he's representing his client, he should have two persons to protect the dignity. His client and then himself also. Gone are the days when in the East India Company's courts or in the chartered courts, the lawyers used to behave like servants. For everything, they would say, yes, my lord. Why yes, my lord? My lord may not be saying everything correct. You can always respectfully disagree with humility. And whenever there is a proper ground or a serious, this is the rules of conduct, duty towards the court. Amazing. And whenever there is a complaint against a judicial officer, it shall be his right and duty to submit his grievance to the proper authorities. That is why I said, these rules of conduct are just not his right to protect himself, right to or some kind of obligation upon them. These are his rights also. If he is not getting a proper treatment in court, Bar Council rules provide him a right to make a complaint. But advocate shall maintain towards the courts a respectful attitude, bearing in mind that the dignity of a judicial office is essential for survival of a free community. You know, when you respect a judge, you're not respecting an individual. You are respecting the office of the judge. You're respecting the legal system. And remember, without a strong and independent judicial system, there cannot be independence, for which our country had fought for hundreds of years and which has been now enshrined in our constitution of it. So when you are respecting a judge, you are in fact giving a respect to the judicial system. It is not an individual. And if you give respect to the judicial system, it gives respect to you. And that's how we protect the rights of the citizens. Then there are other rules of conduct about dress, about one very important thing. An advocate, there is a dress prescribed. This is dress, you know, gives you an appearance, a respectable, honorable appearance. Dress also, many a times young lawyers have asked me, why should we wear this gown? Why should we wear this band? These are all colonial, these are all British legacies. You're right. These are British legacies. But remember, this gives you respect. I was very unhappy to see in hospitals when the doctors have stopped wearing the white aprons. Remember what will happen if the lawyers don't wear their uniforms? I think they will lose a lot of respect among the general public. They don't wear the uniform for fun or for any pleasure of it. Uniform gives an obligation, a trust, a duty, and respect. Like in army, in police, suppose an army man says, why should I wear a uniform? I'm not at war all the times. Suppose a policeman says, what is the need of a uniform? My badge is enough. it not only gives him authority, it shows that he's a man who has to be trust, who can be trusted. And it gives a respect, self-respect to him. I feel very, very uneasy when I find that lawyers wearing uniform walking on the streets, lawyers wearing uniform in the religious or political processions, lawyers wearing uniform following the political leaders, it's very disgraceful to the legal profession. And as a practice of ethics and etiquette, it should not be done. Uniform is for court. When you come out of the court, take off your band. Do not continue to wear the band in your car, people, so that the people should watch the lawyer is going. They know you as a lawyer because of your skill and wisdom, not because of your band. Band is to be worn in court. And band is a sign of respect that you are a qualified lawyer or an enrolled lawyer. All right. Now let me come to the duty to the client. Now this is where ethics plays a very important role. A lawyer, what are the duties toward the client? A normal answer would be, I should protect his rights. I should present his case well. I should give him correct advice. It's not just that. You know, a lawyer engaged by signing a wakalatnama. It's a contract between the lawyer and the client. And what is the contract? Contract is, I will represent you in court of law. I will protect your rights. I will plead and present your case and argue and submit your points, which are forceful in law, valid in law, so that you may succeed. But remember one thing, lawyer doesn't have a guarantee of success. Ultimately, it is the judge who writes the judgment. That is, ultimately, it is the person who decides the case. So lawyer has got obligation only to present his case truthfully. He should not cook up a case. The problem with lawyers these days is they want to win every case. No lawyer can win every case. I can tell you with my 40 years of experience, 25 years as a lawyer and 15 years as a judge, no lawyer can guarantee you that you will win the case. No lawyer can predict the result of the case. All he has to do is truthfully, faithfully, forcefully protect the rights of your clients. Now, Wakalatnama has got one very important line. And many litigants don't look into that line. And that is that I give you authority to withdraw my case. Or I give you authority to give up certain law points, concede. Now, ethically, a lawyer cannot do it. But the Wakalatnama authorizes him to do so. So one has to be very careful at the time of signing the Wakalatnama that this right which you are giving to the lawyer should not be given unconditionally. The ethics say that, of course, you can withdraw the case, but with the permission of your client. You can give up a law point with the consent and permission of your client. You cannot. Once it so happened that I was representing a mother in a custody case, and the judges were very harsh on me. They said, you produce the child right now. I said, my lord, the child is not well. I've met the child, is running high temperature. I'll produce him tomorrow in the morning in the court. Then the judges said, we will send you to jail. I said, you can't do that. I'm defending my client. And my client says to the mother, the child is not a condition to be produced in court today. They said, we will take some measures against you as a lawyer, because they got angrier. All right. I said, please do take your measures, whatever you want to take. But please, I want to withdraw from this case. Then they said, you have a permission to withdraw. I said, you cannot give me permission to withdraw also, unless I seek the consent of my client. What is going on just now is between judge and the lawyer. Client doesn't know it. Client may not like me to withdraw from the case. Then I have no liberty at that time. So, you know, you can withdraw from a case, a lawyer can withdraw from a case, provided he informs the client and takes his consent. You are not the master of the case. The client is the master of the case. You are only representing him in the case. So a lawyer's duties are not just whatever that he wants to do. These are the conducts, these are the duties towards the client which he must adhere. Now, in defending your client, many a time some lawyers have asked me, I know he's a criminal, how do I defend him? You are not defending a criminal. You are defending an individual against whom some criminal charges have been leveled. He has a right to defend himself. He cannot be punished unless the charges have been established by a relevant, cogent, and admissible evidence in law. Even a prosecutor has to prove that. If suppose a person says, yes, I have committed this murder or I have committed this crime, that cannot punish him unless the prosecutor brings the charges, proves the charges by a relevant and cogent evidence, only then the judge gets a right to punish him, declare him guilty, and then punish him by adequate punishment. So you are only defending the right of the person for a fair trial. Now, what happened in the case of Ajmal Kasab? All of you must have known the case of Ajmal Kasab. The terrorists, when they came through the sea, attacked on Taj Mahal Hotel in Bombay. Ajmal Kasab was a 24-year-old young boy. He had no passport with him. He had nothing to prove his nationality. He was carrying a gun. He was along with his team. And he alone had killed 28 persons. Then his rifle was snatched. We all know the story. Then when he was tried, everybody was saying, why is he being tried? Everybody has seen him killing the people. He's not an Indian. He's a terrorist. He had an AK-47 with him. He was caught while doing this, killing the people. He said, no, you cannot do that. Even if you catch a criminal in the act of committing crime, you have to bring him to court, charge him, establish the charges against him. That is the strength of law. That is the strength of the legal system. Okay. Then what happened? Then the courts gave him an amicus curiae. The amicus curiae helped him in defending himself. Then the amicus curiae, when the matter went to Supreme Court, in Supreme Court, a very important question was raised. He had actually, initially in the beginning, admitted to the crimes. Then he retracted. So one of the questions was whether his retraction was valid. Another question, whether he was provided proper legal aid. So even such a rank terrorist has a right to legal aid. And you as a lawyer cannot defend. You know what happened? There was a terrorist incident in Ayodhya. In Ayodhya, some terrorists were caught red-handed. When they were brought to court, a resolution was passed by the Bar Association of Ayodhya that no one will defend him. You can't do that. The Bar Association or Bar Council does not have a right to pass a resolution that they will not defend a person, however heinous crime he may have committed. Because what you are doing is you are taking away his right. The Bar Association as a body doesn't have a right to take over the right of a person. All right. So, another thing which is ethical is to keep the accounts of the clients. You know, in advocate on record examination, there is a paper of accounting, account keeping. Now, Justice Ranka must be knowing it very well, that account keeping is very important for a professional. And one of the regulations of conduct against the vis-a-vis the lawyer and the client is that a lawyer has to keep an account of in-pocket expenses and out-pockets, of all the expenses that he is doing, of what he is charging as a fees. And a client has a right at any stage of the suit, okay, sir, mere ko mere account de dijiye. Maybe for taxation purposes or otherwise. I don't know how many lawyers are keeping their accounts of their clients. They are not. So this is something which is against the ethics of a lawyer. He has to keep it. Then he has to protect the original papers. I have seen lawyers keeping original papers in their files, in their cars. In the courtroom, they are lying like that in the open files. A lawyer ordinarily does not know whether the client has given him the document of title or his original papers and where he has kept them. It is his duty and responsibility. It's a very important part of the ethics. In Supreme Court, I saw Justice Mukul Mudgal, in whose chamber I initially joined there in Supreme Court. He became Chief Justice of Punjab and Haryana High Court. He had a special locker in his office where he used to keep the original papers, cataloged original papers. That in this case, the client has given me these papers. He used to give receipt to that client that I have received these original papers to you and I am in trustee of these original papers. These are the rules of the ethics which you have to follow. Then duty towards opponent. You will not discuss the points of your case with your opponent counsel. You will not communicate or negotiate with him without the knowledge of your client. These are some rules. You may be very good friends at the bar, best friends. There may be two brothers who are representing their adversaries, but they are not supposed to discuss the strong or weak or points of the client, their clients among themselves, or as to what they are going to do in future. These are purely private, confidential communications between client and counsel. Then there is a duty towards colleagues. And one of the duty towards colleagues, you know, the Bar Council has said in Regulation 36, an advocate shall not solicit work or advice, either directly or indirectly. Now, many people have asked me, my young colleagues have asked me, even I had this question, why can't I advertise? Meri wakalat chalegi kaisi jab tak logon ko pata nahi chalega ki main vakeel. You know, there is a strong principle behind it, very strong. That principle is that when you become a lawyer, you acquire certain skills and competence. You cannot sell your skill and competence. These are not commercial, these are not for commercial sale. A lawyer is not supposed to advertise. Even the Bar Council rule says his nameplate should not be of a high, big size. Now, these days, we see the lawyers putting big posters. Main secretary ki post ke liye khada hua hoon. Ye mera photo hai, ye mera qualification hai, ye mera number. This is all unethical. A person who's trying to be getting elected as a chairman of the Bar Council advertises himself for this practice, cannot do it. Advertisement by lawyer is bad, unethical, because there you are actually, what you are doing is, you are going in for commercial sale of your skills. That is not permissible. So you have to develop your practice on merit, so that people should know you. How are lawyers engaged? You know, it was very surprising. In UP, I used to ask, aap mere paas kyun aaye hain? Kya hota tha ki har aadmi apni jati ka vakil chahta hai, apni caste ka. तो हमने पूछा आप अपनी कास्ट का वकील क्यों चाहते हैं? बोले साहब हमें उस पर विश्वास होता है. रिमेंबर वन ट्रस्ट. इफ यू डोंट ट्रस्ट योर लॉयर यू कांट यू विल नॉट एंगेज हिम. सो हाउ डू यू डेवलप दैट ट्रस्ट? ये मेरी जाति का है, ये मेरे इलाके का है, इसको फलाने ने रिकमेंड किया है, तो भैया तो मेरे पास क्यों आए? मैं तो तुम्हारी जाति का नहीं हूं. साहब हम आपका नाम सुन के आया था. तो जब आप जाति और जान पहचान से ऊपर उठ जाते हैं, तब आप समझिए कि आप प्रोफेशन में सक्सेसफुल हो रहे हैं, क्योंकि लोग आपको आपकी मेरिट पे एंगेज करने लगे. सो इट्स अ वेरी स्ट्रेंज थिंग. आई मीन प्रोफेशन वेयर यू कांट एडवर्टाइज, देन हाउ डू पीपल विल नो यू? हाउ व्हेन विल यू प्रूव योर मेरिट? सपोज यू डोंट हैव अ फादर और अ गॉड फादर इन प्रोफेशन, आपको 10 साल लग जाएंगे अपना नाम बनाने में प्रोफेशन, आप क्या तब तक इंतजार करेंगे? तो लोग लालच में आके अपना एडवर्टाइजमेंट करने लगते हैं. कोई इलेक्शन में, आप जानते हैं इलेक्शन में इतने लोग क्यों खड़े होते हैं? इसलिए नहीं कि उनको जीतना है, इसलिए कि वो एडवर्टाइजमेंट हो जाएगा, उनका नाम आगे बढ़ जाएगा. इट इज नॉट करेक्ट. द बार काउंसिल्स रूल्स प्रोहिबिटेड. देन देयर इज वन थिंग विच इज मिसिंग, जो अब आ गई, लॉयर इन सोशल मीडिया. इसके लिए अभी तक बार काउंसिल ने कोई रेगुलेशन नहीं बनाए. ए लॉयर शुड नॉट गो एंड सॉलिसिट वर्क. Lawyer should not. आजकल आप देखेंगे सारे इंटरव्यूज में, सारे चैनल्स में वकील आ रहे हैं, अपने ओपिनियन दे रहे हैं. अभी मुकदमा कोर्ट में पहुंचा ही नहीं है, वक्त इनका ओपिनियन पहले आ गया. दिस इज नॉट डन, दिस इज अनएथिकल. इवन द बेस्ट ऑफ द लॉयर्स व्हेन दे कम, चाहे वो बड़े बड़े नाम हो, दे कैन नॉट कम. अभी तो केस चल रहा है, इट इज अ ट्रायल स्टेज और इट इज इन कोर्ट. यू कैन नॉट कम एंड गिव योर ओपिनियन. नोबडी इज एंगेज्ड टू डू दैट एंड नोबडी ऑथराइज यू टू गिव योर ओपिनियन इन कोर्ट. नो चैनल हैज अ राइट टू आस्क यू अ क्वेश्चन लाइक दैट. दूसरी प्रॉब्लम तब होती है जब लॉयर्स अपने को पॉलिटिकल पार्टी से और रिलीजियस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन से कनेक्ट कर लेते हैं. एब्सोल्यूटली अनएथिकल. छोड़ दीजिए ना, वकालत छोड़ दीजिए, आप ज्वाइन कर लीजिए पॉलिटिक्स. बट वॉट इज हैपनिंग इज बिकॉज ऑफ योर ज्वाइनिंग पॉलिटिक्स योर प्रैक्टिस पिक्स अप. एंटायरली अनएथिकल. नो लॉयर शुड बी पार्ट ऑफ एनी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बिकॉज यू ही नेवर नोज when his role will become in conflict interest with that organization. Religious organizations, political organizations, social organizations, they are openly advocating and calling themselves, aiye ye senior vakil aaye hain, ye aapko batayenge, ye is political party se concerned. What a part of the ethics should not be done. Ab, before I take the questions, I'll just refer to one case. Ek case aapko bata dein sir. आप लोगों ने नाम सुना होगा मिस्टर वीसी मिश्रा का, विनय चंद मिश्रा. विनय चंद मिश्रा हमारे इलाहाबाद के वकील थे. श्रीवास्तव साहब जानते होंगे, प्रमोद श्रीवास्तव जी वीसी मिश्रा साहब को. वीसी मिश्रा साहब से मेरे बड़े घनिष्ठ संबंध थे, मैंने उनसे बहुत कुछ सीखा भी है. एक समय ऐसा आया 1995-96-97 जब वीसी मिश्रा बिकेम अ किंग ऑफ लीगल प्रोफेशन. वो बार एसोसिएशन के प्रेसिडेंट थे हाईकोर्ट के, यूपी बार काउंसिल के चेयरमैन थे और फिर बार काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया के चेयरमैन हो गए. एवरीथिंग वेंट टू हिज हेड. अब वो कोर्ट में जज को ओपनली थ्रेट करते थे. आई एम अ विटनेस टू दैट सीन जिसमें उन्होंने जस्टिस कशोट, राजस्थान से गए थे जस्टिस कशोट इलाहाबाद, उन्होंने ओपन कोर्ट में उनको अब्यूज किया. यू नो व्हाट हैपेंड, जस्टिस कशोट wrote a letter to our Chief Justice, Justice Khanna. Khanna साहब की हिम्मत नहीं थी V.C. मिश्रा के खिलाफ contempt का action लेने की, तो he referred it to Supreme Court. Supreme Court में पूरी hearing हुई, उनकी apology accept नहीं की गई, उसको कहा गया ये conditional apology है, it is not truly from the heart, and he was debarred from 5 years. That's a celebrated case on legal misconduct in the court. एकदम से application पड़ी Advocate on Record Association की. एक रिव्यू पिटिशन पड़ी कि सुप्रीम कोर्ट कैन नॉट डिबार अ लॉयर बिकॉज दिस राइट इज ओनली विद द बार काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया. विद द बार काउंसिल लॉ, बार काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया और दोनों की कंकरेंट पावर्स. द सुप्रीम कोर्ट क्लेवरली केप्ट द मैटर पेंडिंग फॉर 5 years व्हेन हिज डिबारिंग पीरियड वाज ओवर, एंड देन सुप्रीम कोर्ट हैड टू एक्सेप्ट कि हमारे पास ये पावर नहीं है, दिस पावर इज विद द बार काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया. So even today, if the lawyer misbehaves in court, the court can take an action of contempt against him, but he cannot debar him. This again has a big principle. जो मैंने आपको legal history बताई वो इसीलिए बताई. Lawyer is not servant of the court. Court नहीं उसको enroll करता है. Enroll करता है bar counsel. Bar counsel is a body of his own seniors, his own peers, an elected body. He has to submit himself of ethics and conduct to the scrutiny of the bar. Disciplinary action sirf bar counsel le sakti hai uske khilaf. Then we had a lot of problem when the lawyers started becoming menaces in the court. You know, there was a lawyer in Eta, baap re baap, no judge wanted to hear his case. Jaise hi court mein ghusta tha, pehle mera case lijiye. Then he shout and abuse the judges. Pata nahi Srivastava sahab Eta mein rahe ki nahi rahe. Eta mein ek Mahipal Rana karke ek vakil the. तो हम लोगों ने उनका केस डिसाइड किया कंटेम्प्ट का. हर बार वो अपोलॉजी करके छूट जाते थे. तो अब की बार हम लोगों ने उनको 3 साल के लिए डिस्ट्रिक्ट कोर्ट के प्रेमिसेस में आने से बैन कर. मैटर वेंट टू सुप्रीम कोर्ट. सुप्रीम कोर्ट एक्सेप्टेड इट दैट यस, इन ऑर्डर टू प्रोटेक्ट द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ जस्टिस, इन ऑर्डर टू प्रोटेक्ट द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ जस्टिस, यू विल नॉट डिबार हिम, ही कैन प्रैक्टिस बट ही विल नॉट एंटर द कोर्ट बाउंड्री. दैट प्रिंसिपल हैज बीन एक्सेप्टेड. जस्टिस चौहान साहब के साथ वो जजमेंट दिया था मैंने. अब बस चलते चलते एक बात बता दूं आपको, जब मैं राजस्थान आया तो रंका साहब के मुंह पे स्माइल आ गई. देयर वाज अ मैसिव स्ट्राइक गोइंग ऑन, मैसिव स्ट्राइक. पूरा राजस्थान बंद था। मेरे कुलीग्स ने उससे पूछा कि आप योर एक्टिंग चीफ, व्हाट इज योर ओपिनियन अबाउट द स्ट्राइक, हाउ आर यू गोइंग टू रिजॉल्व इट। आई सेड डोंट वरी, मैं यूपी से आया हूँ, यूपी में स्ट्राइक्स इज अ नॉर्मल फीचर, वी नो हाउ टू डील विथ इट। जस्टिस काटजू साहब जब थे, जब कानपुर में स्ट्राइक हुई तो मुझे एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव जज बना देते थे, जब इलाहाबाद में स्ट्राइक होती थी तो वहाँ एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव जज बना देते थे। और मैं वकीलों से एक ही बात कहता था, मैं आपकी बहुत इज्जत करता हूँ, मैं भी वकील हूँ, ये आपकी रोजी रोटी है, आप अपनी रोजी अपनी दुकान बंद करके हड़ताल मत कीजिए। आप कितने दिन चलेंगे, हमें तो तनख्वाह मिलती रहेगी, आपको एक न एक दिन विड्रॉ करनी पड़ेगी, तो अभी मान जाइए इज्जत से, एक दूसरे के साथ बैठ के प्यार से मान लेते हैं। और यही हुआ, अल्टीमेटली दे रियलाइज दैट स्ट्राइक इज अगेंस्ट देम, दे वर नॉट स्ट्राइकिंग वर्क टू गेन एनी एडवांटेज, दे वर स्ट्राइकिंग देयर ओन, अपने घर का चूल्हा बंद कर रहे थे। अरे ये कैसे कर रहे हो भैया? सो स्ट्राइक इज नो सोल्यूशन, निगोशिएशन, इफ द जुडिशरी इज रॉन्ग वी आर रेडी टू एक्सेप्ट। अगर हमने आपको कोई फैसिलिटीज नहीं दी हैं, आपके इंटरेस्ट के अगेंस्ट काम किया है, वी एक्सेप्ट इट, वी विल इमीडिएटली रेमेडी यू। बट व्हेन यू कम टू द कोर्ट, यू डोंट कम फॉर योरसेल्फ, यू कम फ्रॉम योर क्लाइंट। योर क्लाइंट शुड नॉट सफर, इफ ही सफर्स देन होल सिस्टम फेल्स, एंड व्हेन द होल सिस्टम फेल्स यू ऑल्सो फेल। सो व्हाट इज द ऑब्जेक्ट, यू कैन नॉट डिस्ट्रॉय योरसेल्फ एंड सेव देन यू आर गुड। एंड इफ यू थिंक दैट यू कैन थ्रेटन द जुडिशियल सिस्टम, oh, judicial system is very powerful. Judicial system has unseated even the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. Don't bother about it. Judicial system has a power to protect itself. But judicial system is only. Ab chalte chalte ek last ek baat bata dein. Aap log sabne Fali Nariman sahab ka naam suna hoga. Fali Nariman sahab, a great lawyer, very respected lawyer. Ek bar unse pucha gaya, NDTV में पूछा एंकर ने कि सर डू यू थिंक द प्रोफेशन ऑफ लॉ इज ऑनरेबल प्रोफेशन, बल्कि इस ढंग से पूछा डू यू थिंक द प्रोफेशन ऑफ लॉ इज स्टिल ऑनरेबल, तो उनका जवाब बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग था। उन्होंने एक लाइन में जवाब दिया, बोले यस इफ द लॉयर बिहेव्स ऑनरेबली देन इट इज ऑनरेबल प्रोफेशन। तो भाई आप अपनी इज्जत मत खराब कीजिए, सड़क पे कोट पहन के मत खड़े होइए, किसी प्रोसेशन में पार्टिसिपेट मत कीजिए, किसी रिलीजियस और पॉलिटिकल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन से कंसर्न मत कीजिए, एथिक्स को फॉलो कीजिए, एथिक्स आपको प्रोटेक्ट करती हैं, एथिक्स आपके आपके कोई बंदिश नहीं लगाती, ये तो आपको बचाती हैं फ्रॉम एनी एक्शन। सो दैट्स ऑल आई वांट टू से, आई वुड लव टू टेक क्वेश्चंस, बिकॉज क्वेश्चंस आने चाहिए तभी मजा आता है बात करने। यस
Thank you, sir, for such an insightful session. We genuinely understand and we got to know a lot about the rules, the regulations, the ethics. So, in the, you know, when we go to the courts and we see that the people are not doing or wearing or dress code ethically, in short, we see that the people are not ethically right in a courtroom. So, we feel that there's an urge need to understand, especially to the lawyers, that this is the particular rules which we need to follow. And as by the rules doesn't, and rules and ethics doesn't bound you. They are just being prepared to protect you from the bad happenings or so any bad circumstance. And we understand and we really appreciate it. And by this, we want to start our question and answer round. So, sir, first question we have from Vatsal Agarwal. So, Vatsal Agarwal, can you please unmute yourself? Just a second, sir. You can just ask me a question.
Yes.
Okay. Till then, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Good evening, sir. So my question was that how can a person make sure that he or she is ethically sound while he or she is in a court?
While? Please complete.
While he or she is in the court.
Ethically sound.
Yes, sir.
See, I have told you all these things. If he is following all these principles, if he is, you know, the moment the lawyer starts speaking, you know, here is a man who follows ethics. He's humble. His integrity is without any doubt. He represents his client's case forcefully. He knows the law and he does not misbehave. He respects his colleagues. He respects the system, judicial system. And that is ethics. He's following ethics.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering such questions so nicely and in the least word. So the next question, sir, we have from Pradeep Kothari, sir. Okay, yes. So sir, his question, he won't be able to ask it directly. So his question is, how do students learn about their ethical duty to contribute towards justice? So this is the question from Pradeep Kothari, sir.
It's a very good question. Very, very good question. You see, I believe that there should be, in the curriculum of law, there should be one paper on ethics. And in ethics, all these things, including the Bar Council rule, the entire history and background of lawyers, and the Bar Council regulations should be part of the curriculum. If it is not an independent paper, it can be joined with some other paper. But students should know what are ethics of a lawyer when they leave the law college. Because when they apply for becoming enrolled as an advocate, and most of the states, this enrollment process is not a very difficult process. If you have a degree in law, you pay the fees, you get enrolled. But what have you got to do after that? You should know it. So either in the law college or in the bar examination, there should be a paper so that they should read and understand. And they should attend the seminars. Seminars like this, and the colleges should hold seminars on ethics. It has become very essential nowadays. Yes. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir. So next question we have, how does judicial system protect the black sheep in the system?
Very difficult. You know, black sheep cannot be caught unless the cover of the black sheep is removed. There are, black sheep means what? A person who is blatantly unethical. He is a mercenary. You know, what is mercenary? Aapko pata hai kya hota hai? Jo kisi bhi army mein nahi hote, unko aap hire kar lijiye, kahin bhi ladne ke liye. So, some of the lawyers do behave like that. Some of the lawyers think ki to unko kanun aa gaya hai, court mein khade hue hain, to sab kuch kar sakte hain. So, it is the duty of the judges, and I tell you, more than it is the duty of the judges, it is the duty of the fellow lawyers, his own colleagues. You cannot get respect unless the entire body of lawyers get respect. And if there is a black sheep, you expose him. Expose him. If you can't directly expose him, indirectly expose him. Because aapko pata hai, lawyer apne reputation se bahut darta hai. Agar uska reputation kharab ho gaya, to usko koi engage nahi karega. Ye baat alag hai ki kuch log aise logon ko engage karna chahte hain jinka reputation acha nahi. But that's a different matter. Very few people. Most of the people will come to you. They want to come to a good lawyer. Bhai, aapki property hai, aapke rights hain, aapke civil rights hain, constitutional rights hain, aapko kisi criminal case mein phasa diya gaya, to aapko achha wakil chahiye. To aap kisi aise aadmi ke paas nahi jayenge jiska reputation kharab ho. Reputation is very important and reputation travels faster than anything. Aapko pata hai ek bar kya hua? Ek bar main ek Supreme Court judge se milne gaya, to unhone kaha 5 baje shaam ko court se uthke aaye the. बोले यार आज तुम्हारी कोर्ट में ये भी हो गया, आज तुम्हारी कोर्ट में इस वकील ने ऐसा भी कह दिया. मैंने कहा सर ये तो 2 घंटे पहले की बात है, आपको कहां से पता चल गई दिल्ली में? बोले हमको सब पता रहता. दिस रेपुटेशन ट्रेवल्स सो फास्ट एंड इन द वर्ल्ड ऑफ सोशल मीडिया पीपल कम टू नो अबाउट हिम. सो ब्लैक शीप्स कैन बी एक्सपोज्ड बट वी हैव टू टेक रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ एक्सपोजिंग देम. डोंट जस्ट लेट इट ऑन द जजेस बिकॉज इफ यू आर अलाउिंग सच पर्सन टू बी इन द प्रोफेशन. Remember one thing, somebody will lose trust in you. Arre, ye bhi aise ho sakte. So we all have a collective responsibility to expose the black sheep. Yes.
Also, sir, the question in this reference only, how can we shun down these black sheep?
I have given you an answer. Everybody has a collective responsibility, not only judges, but also his colleagues and other people. Report it. If a lawyer is doing something wrong, he should be reported to the Bar Council. Ek bar maine pucha ek vakil sahab se, aap sabse zyada kis cheez se darte hain? बोले साहब बार काउंसिल में कंप्लेंट हो जाती है तो डरते हैं। फिर डरते क्या, कुछ तो होना नहीं है, आप ही के लोग हैं, आपको सजा तो देंगे नहीं। उन्होंने कहा नहीं साहब, रात को नींद नहीं आती, पता नहीं मेरा दुश्मन वहां बैठा हो कमेटी में, डिसिप्लिनरी कमेटी में, और उस मुझे मुझे सजा दे दे, मेरी तो इज्जत चली जाएगी। तो कंप्लेंट की अगर इफ यू फाइंड देयर इज अ ब्लैक शीप, मेक ए कंप्लेंट, डरिए मत। बस एक डर लगता है कि दूसरा कोई वकील मुझे रिप्रेजेंट नहीं करेगा, फिर देयर इज सच ए कोहेजन अमंग देम, बट डोंट बी अफ्रेड। इफ ही इज चीटिंग यू, ही इज चीटिंग एवरीबॉडी एल्स आल्सो, सो प्रोटेक्ट द अदर्स आल्सो फ्रॉम।
Exactly. So we have so many questions, but this will be the last question.
Pick up some of them if we have time.
The last question is, how can we stop or any rules regarding regulations regarding exploitation of junior lawyers?
You see, junior lawyers think that on day one they will become the top man. You know, they have to work very hard, very, very hard. This is a profession in which you cannot be recognized unless you have put in some good years of work, hard work, real hard work. Now, if you don't want to do that hard work and you want an immediate success, to bada mushkil hai, fir to aap galat raste pe chale jayenge. But I tell you from my experience, jisne bhi mehnat ki hai, mehnat means mehnat, real mehnat, usko success mili. This profession is, ek bade wakil ka beta achha wakil nahi ho sakta. कामयाब हो सकता है लेकिन अच्छा वकील नहीं हो सकता जब तक वो खुद मेहनत ना करे, उसको खुद मेहनत करनी पड़ेगी। सो जूनियर लॉयर्स हैव टू वर्क वेरी हार्ड। माय मैसेज टू जूनियर लॉयर्स इज देयर इज नो शॉर्टकट, कीप वर्किंग हार्ड, यू विल सक्सीड। द प्रोफेशन हैज इनफ स्कोप, इनफ स्पेस फॉर एवरी हार्ड वर्किंग पर्सन। भाभी जी नमस्कार।
After seeing the question, if I compare the all the questions, so the most repeated question is how the lawyers can improve their self in the field of law, following the ethical values.
You see, first and foremost thing is that lawyer should know the law.
Yes.
He should work hard. He should work. जब उनको कोई case मिलता है, every matter, every case is an opportunity to learn. Then they should not be shy of seeking advice from others, seniors. जाते ही नहीं है सीनियर से पूछने के लिए, उनको लगता है उनको सब कुछ आता है। Then thirdly, if he wants to succeed, then he must follow all ethics. उसको इतना respectful होना पड़ेगा कोर्ट में कि जज उसकी humility से impressed हो जाए। Hard work तो अपनी जगह है। As I told you, there is enough space in legal profession. All that you see crowds, all this crowds is only crowd. The hardworking people shine out immediately. Within a few years, they will come up. Yes.
Thank you, sir. I think, sir, we have to close the question and answer round. So we have a bundle of questions.
Thanks. Please take my email ID. I will answer every question they want to ask. My email ID is sunilambwani@yahoo.com.
I'll just copy paste all these questions along with the name and email it to you.
I will reply to all of them.
So nice.
So that's a very mark of a leadership, a good leader. Like it is not important, sir, how successful you are. You can only become great when you share that or, you know, give that abundance of your good qualities to the others, which you just reflected as to us. And sir, by this ending our question, and I would request Ms. Surbhi Ranka ma'am to please give the thank you speech.
Just before that, we have a presence of Honorable Mr. Justice Pramod K. Srivastav, former judge, in case he wishes to say a few words as blessings to the students, we'll be happy and delighted. Rishi ji, kindly unmute. Yes.
Namaskar. A few words are not sufficient for Justice Ambani. Inke saath maine जो काम किया है और इन्होंने जो जो काम किया है कोई सोच ही नहीं सकता है। When I was district judge गोरखपुर, तो इनके डायरेक्शन पे हमने एक बहुत बड़ा सिस्टम शुरू किया, जापानीज इंसेफ्लाइटिस का, जो कि हर साल हजारों जाने लेता है ईस्टर्न यूपी में। और इन्होंने जो बनाया, जितने पैसे मैंने मांगे उन्होंने दिए, और एक पूरा सिस्टम हम लोगों का लीगल सर्विसेज अथॉरिटी का एस्टेब्लिश किया था, तो इसके कारण और अनलिमिटेड फंड हमको मिला कम से कम जो जो भी हमने कहा, और इस समय ऑलमोस्ट वो खत्म होने पे बहुत प्रिमिटिव स्टेज पे वो पेंडेमिक है, वरना ईयरली पेंडेमिक लगभग 4 महीने की। इसी तरह एक बार रात को फोन आया आपका मेरे पास कि वहां पर ट्रेन एक्सीडेंट हो गया है, पहली बार अर्ली इन द मॉर्निंग आया था कि ट्रेन एक्सीडेंट हो गया है, उनको कुछ हेल्प करना है। फिर ऑफ कोर्स ही वाज बिहाइंड मी, तो कई जिलों के वहां पे संत कबीर नगर था, वहां पे कई जिलों का बॉर्डर था, ट्रेन एक्सीडेंट हुआ, और विश्वास कीजिए कि 3 या 4 घंटे के अंदर वहां पे पूरा एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन तीनों जिलों का, रेलवे एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन मौके पे पहुंचा, लोगों को न केवल मेडिकल हेल्प दिया बल्कि मॉनिटरी हेल्प जो कि प्रिस्क्राइब है, इंजर्ड को इतना तुरंत का तुरंत हुआ। आप सोच सकते हैं कि 3-4 घंटे के अंदर न केवल आदमी को सबको मेडिकल और मॉनिटरी हेल्थ और फिजिकल हेल्थ मिल जाए, जिसको हॉस्पिटलाइज करना है करे और सबको सुविधा मिल जाए, और लोगों को मालूम भी नहीं हुआ कि इनको सुविधा कहाँ से मिल रही है। बट इट वॉज जस्ट समी। फिर नेक्स्ट टाइम ऐसे ही एक बार रात को फोन आया, मैं सोया था जाने के रात में, सब वहां पे एक्सीडेंट हो गया है। तो नेक्स्ट टाइम तक तो जब हमारे ऑफिस पहुंचे तो डिस्ट्रिक्ट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन और रेलवे एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन भी पहुंचा हुआ था। फिर यही हुआ कि सुबह तक सबको मेडिकल हेल्प हेल्प मॉनिटरी हेल्प जो इनको मिलना है, इंजर्ड को जो मिलना है इतने पैसे, और साथ साथ सबको टिकट भी रेलवे ने तुरंत दिया कि आपको जहां जाना है, और जो इंजर्ड है उनको दिया। और इट वॉज ऑल विद इन ही वॉज एक्टिंग विद इन हिज जुडिशियल कैपेसिटी, स्पेशली जापानीज एक्सीडेंट में जो कंपनसेशन से हेल्प मिली एज चेयरमैन यूपी लीगल सर्विसेज अथॉरिटी। इसी प्रकार अच्छा इनके इसके सारे डायरेक्टर्स जो मेडिकल हेल्प थे, स्पेशली सर्वाइटिस वाले थे, इस जुडिशियल साइड से इन्होंने नजर ने एक सीरीज ऑफ डायरेक्शन इशू किए, और इसके बाद फिर ये पोजीशन हो गई कि जो एक एग्रेसिव बार मानी जाती थी गोरखपुर की, और जो कि वो अचानक न केवल वो हम्बल हो गई कि सब ये सब अपने आप कर रहे हैं, बल्कि खुद ही काम करने लगे लोग कि सब हमसे भी हेल्प ले लीजिए। हमने कहा हो चुका है कि नहीं, सब कुछ तो हम करेंगे, अब क्या करोगे, अगली बार जब एक्सीडेंट होना तब कर। ये नौबत आई इनके लिए बहुत से शख्स हैं, जुडिशियल वर्क के लिए तो कहने नहीं, जैसा बताया वो अच्छी तरह से देख रहे होंगे, समझ रहे होंगे, लेकिन हर फील्ड में एज जज, और इन्होंने इसी तरह बार को बहुत मोटिवेट किया। वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट बार ऑफ यूपी इज दैट ऑफ कानपुर, जैसा इन्होंने बताया, उसको इन्होंने जब मैनेज कर लिया और सब इनका कहना मानते रहे सब।
लीगल फ्रेटर्निटी है, और जब थे तो ऑफिसर जी कहते थे कि चीफ जस्टिस हो तो जस्टिस अंबानी जैसा, वेरी बोल्ड स्ट्रॉन्ग। Yes.
जब ये चले गए इलाहाबाद से तो हम लोग ने बहुत मिस किया, और हम चलिए अप्रिशिएट किया कि एक कुछ और ज्यादा कर सकते हैं इस चीफ जस्टिस,
थैंक यू,
बहुत मिस किया
इन्हें। सो नाइस ऑफ यू जस्टिस श्रीवास्तव। रेणु जी वुड लाइक टू से समथिंग?
नहीं, भैया को यही बोलना चाह रही थी कि हम एज अ लेमैन आल्सो आपकी टॉक को बहुत एंजॉय किया, समझ पाए, तो स्टूडेंट्स जरूर इससे बेनिफिट करे होंगे। थैंक यू सो मच, एंड भाभी जी को प्रणाम।
थैंक यू।
यस मेघा।
यस, ओवर टू यू सुरी मैम। थैंक यू मैम।
Thank you for inviting.
Yes.
Honorable Chief Justice Sri Sunil Ambani Ji, former Chief Justice of Rajasthan High Court, the guest of honor, Honorable Mr. Justice V.S. Dave Sahab, Honorable Mr. Justice Sri J.K. Ranka, the respected members of School of Law from the Vivekanand, from the VGU School of Law, Justice Pramod K. Srivastava, Sri S.S. Bissa Ji, a retired IAS, Professor Anil Gujar, all the lawyers and students present here. It is my honor and my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for this 12th Dr. N.M. Ranka Memorial Lecture Series, which is organized by the Rajasthan Public Charitable Trust in association with the VGU School of Law and Rajasthan Education Trust. On behalf of the entire organizing team, I would like to sincerely extend a vote of thanks to Honorable Chief Justice Sri Sunil Ambani Ji for just giving your valuable time. The topic for today was so much apt as in the present day scenario, and you have actually so much vividly and so easily taken all of us through the ups and downs, you know, and then the reasons that why we should actually follow the code of conduct as well as the code of ethics, and how one can actually become more protected and more successful if you honestly follow all the rules, regulations, which are laid down in the code of ethics and all. So, and a deeps, and we have certainly gained a lot by hearing you today. Your insights and your words of wisdom, which you articulated during this session, will actually go a long way for all the participants here. And we extend our kindest gratitude and warmest regards to you for gracing us. A deep sense of appreciation and gratitude it goes out to you. And the backbone to this event are the ever enthusiastic and the passionate bunch of students without whom this event would not have been possible. I would like to express my sincere thanks to Parth, Megha, and to each one of them in the team who have worked tirelessly to bring up this event for all of us. The primary source of information, of inspiration behind this lecture series is Dr. Sri N.M. Ranka. He was an avid motivator to all the young professionals and students of law, and he continues to be the super guiding light for this lecture series, which we shall be continuing for furthermore sessions. So with this once again, I am most grateful to Honorable Justice Sri Sunil Ambani. And honestly, sir, aaj aapko sunke aise laga ki jaise ki aaj hum bade papa ko khud sun rahe hain. After long, long time, we have actually heard. And this was his favorite, like topic also, jo ki wo sabko bahut acche se samjhate the. And matlab jiske piche basically unki puri life rahi hai, which is ethics. So thank you so much, sir, for your valuable time and your really valuable insights. We are very, very grateful and really sorry for all this background trouble, because I'm at a place jahan pe net, light, sabka thoda sa samasya hai. So sorry for this, for this backdrop disturbance. But it has been a great pleasure to host you all this evening, and thank you so much for all your time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Subhi ma'am, for your time, despite being a vulnerable network issue. It was a pleasure hearing you and having you here. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Ranka sir. Thank you, Babaji.
Thank you. So nice of you, sir. We will keep on disturbing you for the benefit of the students.
You're most welcome.
Because students would like to hear you on different, on diverse subjects, sir.
Sure.
So nice and grateful to you, sir. All the best.
Thank you.
My regards to Babaji and my young daughters who are budding, become so good lawyers of repute in Delhi. Yeah. All the very best, sir. Thank you, everyone.